can get out the sound board or so that we have a new brand new person here who can see the song. This is a song we sang in middle class because it's a meditation on Krishna's pastime. It's a really short song.
Mahato,
Vaya,
te mahato bhayat.
Neha vikrama nashosti.
Neha vikrama nashosti.
Pratyavayo na vidyate.
Pratyavayo na vidyate.
Svalpam api asya dharmasya.
Svalpam api asya dharmasya.
Trayate mahato bhayat.
Trayate mahato bhayat. Nihavikramanashosti Pratyavayo na vidyate Svalpam api asya dharmasya Trayate mahato
bhayat.
Nihavikramanashosti
Pratyavayo na vidyate
Pratyavayo na vidyate Svalpamapiyasya dharmasya
Trayate mahato
bhayat
Neha vikrama nasosti
Pratyavayo na vidyate
Svalpamapiyasya
dharmasya
Trayate mahato
bhayat
Neha vikrama nasosti
Pratyavayo na vidyate
Svalpamapiyasya dharmasya
Trayate mahato bhayat Neha vikrama nasosti
Pratyavayo na vidyate
Svalpamapiyasya dharmasya
Trayate mahato bhayat
Neha vikrama nasosti
Pratyavayo na vidyate
Svalpamapiyasya dharmasya Trayate mahato bhayat
Na. There is not.
Iha.
In this yoga.
Avikrama.
In endeavoring.
Nasha.
Loss.
Asti.
There is.
Pratyavaya.
Diminution.
Never.
Vidyate.
There is.
Svalpam.
A little.
Api.
Although.
Asya.
Of this.
Dharmasya.
Occupation.
Trayate.
Releases.
Mahato. From very great.
Bhayat.
Danger. Translation and purport by His Divine Grace, Mr. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. Translation was, I'll read the whole thing and then we can give parts of time. In this endeavor, there is no loss or diminution, and a little advancement on this path can protect one from the most dangerous type of fear. Let's repeat. In this endeavor,
there is no loss or diminution.
And a little advancement
on this path
can protect one
from the most dangerous type of fear.
Activity in Krishna consciousness, or acting for the benefit of Krishna without expectation of sense gratification, is the highest transcendental quality of work. Even a small beginning of such activity finds no impediment, nor can that small beginning be lost at any stage. Any work begun on the material plane has to be completed, otherwise the whole attempt becomes a failure. But any work begun in Krishna consciousness has a permanent effect, even though not finished. The performer of such work is therefore not at a loss, even if his work in Krishna consciousness is incomplete. 1% then in Krishna consciousness bears permanent results, so that the next beginning is from the point of 2%. Whereas in material activity, without 100% success, there's no profit. Ajamila performed his duty in some percentage of Krishna consciousness, but the result he enjoyed at the end was 100% by the grace of the Lord. There is a nice verse in this connection in Srimad Bhagavatam 1:5:17. Tyatra swadharmam charanam bhujanarutam. Tyatva swadharmam charanam bhujan harer bhujipad bhajan abhat bhajan abhat bhavata patek patolyari tatrakwa dhira vibhadram abhud amushyakin bhavata apto bhajatam swadharmata. Quote, if someone gives up his occupational duties and works in Krishna consciousness, and then falls down on account of not completing his work, what loss is there in his part? And what can one gain if one performs his material activities properly? Unquote, that's a translation. Or as the Christians say, what profit of a man if he gain the whole world yet suffers the loss of his eternal soul? Material activities and their results end with the body. But work in Krishna consciousness carries a person again to Krishna consciousness even after the loss of the body. At least one is sure to have a chance in the next life of being born again as a human being, either in the family of a great cultured Brahmana or in a rich aristocratic family that will give one a further chance for elevation. That is the unique quality of work done in Krishna consciousness. I was born in the darkest of ignorance. The spiritual master opened my eyes with the torch of knowledge and offered me respectful obeisances unto him. I'll read the translation again. In this endeavor, there is no loss or diminution, and a little advancement on this path can protect one from the most dangerous type of fear. Okay, before we proceed, let's answer two questions. What endeavor? In this endeavor, there's no loss or diminution. Let's be a little specific. This endeavor means the endeavor of working to please Krishna instead of oneself. So we normally in this material world, we try to work for our own gain. And that's expected. You know, you work for your own gain. You please yourself, please your family, whatever is related to you, you expect some gain from your endeavors. And if your endeavors fail, you don't get the gain. But this endeavor is talking about how you do, either do your duty, or as Prabhupada mentioned in the book, you might give up your duty in order to serve Krishna. So that's a higher, it's more specifically Krishna related. Your duty might be practical work. And you, whatever is your real duty in the practical world, you do that for Krishna and offer him the results. Or you renounce that and just do things particularly related to Krishna, like service in a temple, for example, or service of preaching Krishna consciousness, something like that. So these things are, it doesn't matter how little of it you do, you never lose it. You never lose that credit. Whereas, you know, you do something in one lifetime, you die, and all you get is your karma. You don't really get, you know, you don't get to continue the gain, according to this. So that's what the endeavor is. And what's the most dangerous type of fear? Well, the reason we have fear at all, ultimately, is because we're afraid something will cause us to die, right? So that's the most dangerous thing, is that you might die. And what could be more dangerous than dying? Dying lots of times. So staying in the material world and continuing to reincarnate in different kinds of bodies, facing different kinds of deaths, that's more dangerous than in one lifetime we're afraid of dying. You know, it's more dangerous. So this protects one from that. If you start serving Krishna, then you're on your way out of the material world. So instead of facing endless millions of deaths, maybe one more, maybe a couple or something like that. You know, but this is vastly reduced. So, and the fear is, not just dying, but having to be in an animal body and losing your intelligence, losing your knowledge. And then you have to fight tooth and claw all the time. And for aesthetics, we're so used to beautiful things, and for aesthetics you get bushes and dirt and bugs, and that's it. So who really wants that? So this kind of thing is most dangerous type of fear, to continue reincarnating in all kinds of bodies in the material world. So now we've figured out what the endeavor is and what the fear is. Now we can talk about the point here. There's no loss or diminution in devotional service. Devotional service, as I said, could be doing your duty for Krishna, or it could be actually doing specifically Krishna-related service. So, devotional service specifically means pleasing Krishna's senses. Using your senses to please Krishna's senses. Like if you cook for Krishna, you know what makes good cooking. You don't cook just any old thing that I can't use my senses. No, you use your senses, but you want to make it taste good for Krishna. So you use the senses. But you're not thinking, I'm going to really enjoy this, I can't wait to taste it. No, you're thinking, I can't wait to give it to Krishna. And you control your mind that way. It's not as hard as you think. Control your mind that way. And afterwards, after the offering, you can eat it. Yeah. And then at that time, you are also doing emotional service because you're honoring Krishna's mercy, which he put in the food for you by accepting it. So, it's some idea of devotional service. And it's easier than an impersonal path. This path is a personalist path. Krishna's a person, we do things for Krishna. It's easier than the impersonalist path. So let's look at this. This is in 12, chapter 12. We're in 12, 5 and 7. So I'll just read English. For those whose minds are attached to the unmanifested, impersonal feature of the Supreme, advancement is very troublesome. To make progress in that discipline is always difficult for those who are embodied. It means you're in a body, the senses, to try to successfully meditate on the impersonal aspect of the Lord. It's very austere. It's really, really difficult to make progress. So, Krishna says, but those who worship me, giving up all their activities unto me, and being devoted to me without deviation, engaged in devotional service and always meditating upon me, having fixed their minds upon me, the son of Pita, for them I am the swift deliverer from the ocean of Vrindavan. So who is this me? This is not only Krishna, but this is Krishna sitting across from Arjuna in a chariot, physically visible as his cousin. They're cousins and they're best friends. And they're facing a great war. This is Krishna's pastime. Krishna is in his eternal spiritual body, which he can do what he wants with it. So in this case, he looks like a human. So then he looks more beautiful, but he's walking around like a human. And Arjuna is walking around like a human because he is. He's in a material body that's a human body. So they're playing these roles in this pastime. And the whole Bhagavad Gita is where Arjuna became overwhelmed with doubt right before the war. And the war was Krishna's plan, so that Krishna wanted to help Arjuna get over this doubt so he could fight in the war like a hero. And this discussion is what this is for. So anyway, this is Krishna, personal Krishna, in his own eternal spiritual form, telling Arjuna, those who worship me, giving up all their activities unto me, being devoted to me without deviation, engaged in devotional service, and always meditating upon me. And if so minds upon me, so Pita, for them I am the swift deliverer from the ocean of birth and death. So not only is the personal path more satisfying because we can do regular things and offer them to Krishna. We don't just dry up. We're not to just dry up and not do anything and somehow stay focused on that emptiness. No, we get to do all our natural things. And we do them with love and devotion for Krishna. And Krishna is so sweet that it's relishable, it's pleasant, it's pleasurable to do for Krishna. And Krishna helps. You know, he responds. It's a personal relationship. Krishna is a person, and appreciates this reaching out resource. We are lost souls. We once rebelled and left Krishna. And he came with us in our heart, invisibly, to help us, but he wants us to choose him back again. And so when we start choosing him back again, he's so appreciative that he helps us. And we can't do it by ourselves anyways. He's God, he put us here, we have to have him helping us. So, but it's hard. It's a hard path. Devotees start this path and many of them fall away or fall down and stumble. You know, the requirements are strict to make advancement, so it's hard. So it's hard, first of all, it's hard to accept it. A lot of people don't want to actually become a Hare Krishna. They don't want to actually serve God. Why is that? They don't want to surrender. I've been pleasing myself, I've been doing just fine, I'm used to it, I know myself, I want to please me. One nice thing about this verse, it says there's no loss or diminution, even a little advancement on this path. So you only really have to start off surrendering a little bit. There's some chanting, you try it for a minute. Okay. So that counts, that you're 1%. Already. It's made easy in that way. So it's easier than in person when you have to be all dried up. You can just take part in something fun. So we have to do a little bit of surrender, and it grows, of course. But ultimately, we have to totally surrender and love. But in the beginning, we don't have to. And as long as we're unwilling to totally surrender, we have free will to do as we love. But why is it so hard? Why do we fall or fail? Sometimes devotees fail to stick with it. Sometimes devotees fall down back into sinful activity. Why is that? Well, Arjuna asked that question. Chapter 3, text 36, and we'll read this to 3 and 6. Arjuna asked, Arjuna said, O descendant of Rishi, by what is one impelled to simple acts, even unwillingly, as if engaged by force? Don't we find that happen sometimes? So Krishna says, the Supreme Personality of Godhead said, it is lust only, Arjuna, which is born of contact with the material mode of passion and later transformed into wrath, which is the all-devouring sinful enemy of this world. That's the mode of passion. The mode of passion, that is, there's three modes in the material world. They're like the three primary colors, and they mix in all different ways, and so we have all the colors, and they repeat themselves a lot, like different, really different things may have the same color. Well, same thing with the modes. So different kinds of things may have the same kind of modes, but the modes are always changing. Like even for one person, in the early morning, you rise and things seem like pure and peaceful and everything, and you feel kind of peaceful at heart, peaceful at mind. Later on in the day, you think, well, I got things to do, I got to accomplish things, and if I want any results, I got to work. And then even later, get tired, time to go to bed, don't want to think about things, or you have to dive into sleep, forget everything. So we have more goodness, more passion, more ignorance, and the modes are always mixing a little bit anyways. But throughout the day, one person will experience all these changes. So modes are always like changing and competing and combining in different ways. But anyway, especially this mode of passion, this desire to get something that I want to enjoy, is the soul comes into the material world and makes contact with the mode of passion. And that desire to get for me, to work hard and get for me, is lust. It doesn't matter if it's about sex or about other things. It might be about getting a lot of food, it might be about having a big house, it might be about money, it might be about whatever. Maybe somebody wants to collect a lot of stamps, whatever. Whatever you want for yourself, whatever you want to please your senses, that has nothing to do with Krishna, that's influenced by the mode of passion, and work hard to get it, that's under the category of lust. And lust makes us want to get more and more. The living entities are, and it's said elsewhere in the Bhagavad Gita, that living entities are eternal spirit souls that are exploiting the resources in this material world. So that's what we're all doing, right? We're trying to exploit the resources in this world. So the more power you get, driven by this lust, the more exploiting of resources you can do. So you can see what's happening to the environment. You see what's happening to people's spirit and soul. You know, you can see this harm is being done. This lust is the enemy. It's all devouring of this world. And now at this modern age, you can look at the earth and you can say, wow, there's a lot of devouring going on. You see a lot of damage. So don't worry about it. It's going to only increase and you're not going to stop it. People don't know it's by this. It's because of lust. They don't know. They want to see, how can I arrange to get what I want and somehow stop everybody from polluting the world? So I'm not really thinking all the way through. And so, anyways, that's what this lust means. And so lust is there. And so many layers of us, we're covered by so many different layers of lust that we are so accustomed to, we don't even notice that it's that there's our impurities. So we, as we advance in spiritual life, we gradually identify different things that we can try to get over and leave behind. Starting with following rules, if you're given rules at first, what to not do anymore, but then it goes deeper and deeper and deeper. And gradually purifying. So, however, what if we fall down? We're following this path, right? If somebody falls down, okay. They just, hit a rough spot and dove back into sinful activity or something like that. So now what? So I'll show you what Krishna has to say about that. This is not for people who are going to take advantage of Krishna's instruction here that I'm going to read. Because it's not, that's cheating, Krishna knows. But let's see, 9:37, Krishna says, even if one commits the most abominable action, if he is engaged in devotional service, he is to be considered saintly, because he is properly situated in his determination. In text 31, he quickly becomes righteous and attains lasting peace. O son of Kunti, declare boldly that my devotee never perishes. So this is not, as I said, or taking advantage of, if I fall down, and then, keep on doing my devotional service, and so it's all right. But you have to be really trying. You have to be really, the fallback has to be like an accident in the sense of your lower nature got the better of you. But you didn't mean it, and you're trying to rectify yourself. And then there's hope, because Krishna understands that. It's, even if you did the most abominable thing, you can just keep your devotional service and your determination and keep going and you'll become righteous again. So two reasons why he's talking about why it's hard. It's hard because we don't want to surrender, and it's hard because of lust. So it's easy because we can be corrected again. Krishna is a person, Krishna will help us. And in this path, you don't have to be perfect. And the impersonal meditation path, you have to be so dry and so austere and so controlled, and you're all doing it by your own power. You're doing it all by your own power. And it takes actually lifetimes. People think they're meditating nowadays. They empty their mind for 10 minutes or an hour or whatever, they kind of empty it. And they're just putting things on hold. They haven't conquered anything. So they finish the meditation and they're pursuing the same activities inspired by lust. And that's the modern idea of the impersonal meditation. But to actually get out of this material world by impersonal meditation, so you don't incarnate anymore, that's really hard. And even in past ages where the whole earth was more calm and closer to the original spiritual awareness, it was hard then, and it took lifetimes, actually. More than one lifetime to continue this process. Whereas in devotional service, it just depends on where you develop love for Krishna. Even if you fall down, you just keep loving Krishna. So, it's easy. So then, why is it? It's easy because Krishna's a person. And Krishna helps. Not doing it all by ourselves. We're doing it in a loving relationship, doing natural things, and correctly, the right way, but in a loving relationship for Krishna, Krishna does not overlook. Krishna receives. Krishna's in the heart. So even a little bit, even if somebody else can't see that you're doing something for Krishna, Krishna knows that you're doing something for him. I mean, suppose you, I want people to be embarrassed about chanting in the group. They're doing all that rude singing, but privately they may do it. But I know one person first started coming to our Harinam, which means public group chanting of Hare Krishna out in the city. He came, but he came incognito. How did he do that? He was sitting on a nearby park bench with his book. Pretend he didn't see us, pretend he didn't know us. It turned into a big book distributor. That was his beginning. So it then meant Krishna knows, that's your 1% starting, and then you start at 2% and then just keep building that, even if it goes into your next life, so that 1% or that 2% or 10%, and Krishna will arrange so you get a chance to go from there. And keep on adding to it. You can add it all up in one lifetime or over more than one lifetime, and Krishna's still taking care of you. So Krishna helps. He helps from within. He helps us understand too. In Bhagavad Gita 10:10, Krishna 10:10 and 10:11, Krishna helps from within, and he shines a lamp of knowledge in the heart. So we get knowledge intellectually, but it goes into the heart because of our faith. And Krishna shines a light on it and becomes realized knowledge. So there's no loss or diminution. So you can always, and there's no total surrender required at first. You can tentatively put your big toe in the water. You can try it and see. Like you say, you can taste it like the honey jar. Now you can talk about it all you want to, but you open up the honey jar, you taste the honey, you taste the sweet. You don't have to eat the whole jar right away. You can taste it, you can see that it's sweet. So this is, it's like that. And so there's, in the beginning this, there's, to repeat the rule, there's no loss or diminution, even a little advancement will protect you from taking birth again, like in the animal species and everything. You may have to take another birth or two as a human, but not like that. And it's easier than impersonalism. It's hard to accept because we feel we have to surrender, however, then we find that we don't have to surrender all at once. It's easy. It's hard because of lust, but if you fall down, Krishna will help you because you keep trying and Krishna will still protect you. So it's easy. And we don't have to do it by ourselves because Krishna is a person that helps us. So I'll stop there. I'll see if there's any discussion or questions. Yeah.
I was just going to mention that, you may have mentioned it, I might have missed it, but in the beginning, the reason this verse came about, Arjuna asked Krishna, what happens if I don't perfect this?
Yeah.
He's like, and that's where Krishna, the famous verse where Krishna explains about a riveted cloud. The cloud, first word from a big cloud, and then the wind blows it away. No, it's not a big cloud, but it's on the dome, basically. So that's
good. Yeah, that's important. Okay, thank you. Yeah, the image, Arjuna was thinking in images, and so he brought this up. I guess he was thinking in images. He talked about his mind was like a wind. So he said, what if somebody starts on this path? This is way in chapter 12, he asked. Chapter 12? He asked, no, 9. He asked this question. And he already had been told in chapter 2. That there's no loss of diminution if you start on this path. He still had to ask the question all the way in chapter 9. But what if, even we have to ask questions again and again a lot of times, because we get to a new stage and we find the same question needs to be answered for that level. So Arjuna was already, had been brought a long way by Krishna, but still he says, okay, supposing a yogi starts on this path. Yogi means somebody who's practicing this linking with the Supreme, that's what it really means. So a yogi starts on this path and then he fails. He falls away. Okay, he doesn't fit anymore in the material world. He doesn't fit in the spiritual world yet. So like as a cloud is torn and it evaporates and disappears. So is he going to be like that? And it's a good question. Thank you, Sam. It's a good question. Because sometimes in your spiritual path, you feel that. You feel that way. can actually experience that feeling. But Krishna said, don't worry, because Krishna, his devotee never perishes. And even if the devotee falls away and does something abominable, you just keep trying to give devotional service. Krishna will help you and you won't perish. So thank you for being there. Yeah.
Right at the beginning, you mentioned that doing your duty as a service to Krishna or having specific duty in Krishna consciousness.
Yeah.
So I'm a little puzzled by that because aren't they the same thing?
Because what?
Aren't they the same thing?
Oh, yeah, they are. They're the same thing. But one of them is duties that you would have materially anyways. And other is, well, let's see, actions that you would do materially anyways, but specifically doing them in the Krishna temple setting. So, like cooking, okay, materially speaking, you got a family, you got to cook for them. So that would be, okay, I'm going to do this for Krishna because it's your material. Or suppose you have a particular type of talent and ability, so you find work that way, you have to do it. You have responsibilities, you have a family to take care of, you have responsibility to society, you offer your abilities, and so on. So you do it for Krishna. Or you use those talents, or you just use forgiveness and just purely do something specifically Krishna-related. So they're alike, but they're different. So the one is called karma yoga, because karma means the work you get by your karma. Basically, karma means working, it means reaction to work, it means reaction to activities. So you do some things, some work, some activities, you get some karma, and it puts you in a situation where you have some duty to do some work. Right? That's reincarnation. So if you do that work, you can do it for yourself, or you can do it for Krishna. But it's the same duty. But or you can renounce it, join a temple. Go out preaching every day, which is not something you would normally do. Although you do talk to people normally. You do, try to convince people of your opinion. That is a normal activity. But you use that for Krishna and try to convince them to surrender to Krishna. You do some devotional service or something. You take some prasad and some food offered to Krishna. You take this book, chant Hare Krishna or something. There are two different levels, but they're the same thing. One is karma yoga, the other is bhakti yoga, or the yoga of devotion. Does that cover everything you want me to cover?
Well, then does that mean that
you have
to perform only temple-related activities, or
serve
in the temple to be
in
bhakti yoga? Can I not be in my home
and
do bhakti yoga?
Yeah, there's 9 processes of bhakti yoga, and temple is set up to support those processes. And those processes are there independently of temple existence or not. And those processes are hearing about Krishna, chanting about Krishna, or repeating about Krishna, repeating to somebody what you heard or chant his names, remembering Krishna, stationing yourself at Krishna's lotus feet, and offering worship to the deity, which you do at home or in the temple. Offering prayers of praise, becoming the servant, doing whatever is needed, becoming the friend, and offering your whole self are the 9 processes of devotional service, and they're independent of the existence of the temple. However, temples are set up to support specifically those activities. So that's why I say like that. So, yeah, good question. Anything else? Should I say yes, please?
I was going to bring up an analogy that Prabhupada used in connection with this whole point he made. That's like, I always liked it a lot. He said, 2 points. One, the analogy was that if a devotee falls down, it's like in the winter, the city's tree loses all its leaves. But in the springtime, the leaves come back again. Fresh. So he points that it's sort of like when somebody's soul somehow check the services, check for some time, but again, it will be revived.
I like that. Thank
so
you.
Then the other analogy that they would use would be like if someone was in the mafia and they decided they wanted to quit being in the mafia. So they tell the mafia people, I want out. And the mafia people would say, I'm sorry, you can't get out because you know too much. So many times, the whole point of Krishna consciousness is that we talk to a lot of devotees, and they tried to stop. They tried to go back working at Walmart or whatever, but you couldn't get away from that taste of devotional service. Because you suddenly, like one devotee was telling this morning, he was a boxer, and he said, I go back to the arena, I look at people, and I think, they're not their bodies. You know, and he said, they're not their bodies. What am I thinking, you know? And so in that way, you know too much is another aspect of this. It's a little different from somewhere.
It's not, yeah, not, only this is a positive thing, not a negative thing, but yeah, you know, you can't leave it, so you come back. Krishna, Prabhupada said also that even somebody who leaves, they remain affectionately attached to Krishna in their heart. Remembering is devotional service, so they're not stopping their devotional service. How can they forget somewhere in their heart? They're remembering all the nice Krishna conscious activities they did and everything they learned about Krishna. And all the sweet feelings, and they go away, and they can't forget that. So, one thing you can set yourself back quite a bit if you deliberately make serious offenses, maliciousness. Mistaken offenses, this slow you down a bit, you have to like apologize and stuff, but if somebody deliberately makes a serious offense against another devotee or against Krishna, then that will really set you back, so don't do that. Just be careful of yourself. Yeah.
Just like as an affirmation to it, you've been saying, I saved something from the third mantra of the Nectar of Instruction in Prabhupada's purport. He says, the process of bhakti is so pure and perfect that once having begun, one is forcibly dragged to ultimate success. So, I mean, you can't go wrong. It may be a matter of time, as you're saying, that we're separated from realizing the goal, but once started, it's going to have to be fun.
Yeah, so how much do we experience that? Thank you. How much do we experience that we're even get complacent and just somebody turns up in our life and just jog us to move forward or something? Where's that come from? Krishna is dragging us in ways that we don't consciously think we're being dragged, we think we're choosing, but we're going. We're on our way. Anything else? Yeah.
So, like, to preach a newcomers, like those who are very new and want to know about Krishna consciousness or little interested, so what do we ask them to do so that they can get interested in
Krishna? A very new person?
Yeah.
That's a really good question. He wants to know, what can we do? How can we help, what can we say or do for a really new person to get them to want to come along? In the beginning of the introduction to the Bhagavad Gita, no, in the end of the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, this explains, whoever explains this to my devotees, and also it's one of the offenses of the holy name to explain the glories of the holy name to the faithless. So now, what we have to do is we have to make them devotees in a minute. If either you give them some prasadam and they say, oh, it tastes great, and they just honor Krishna, or get them interested in taking a book. Oh, this looks like an interesting philosophy book. Yeah, I like yoga, and, you know, and pretty pictures in it or something, you know. Get them to compliment on the pictures. Anything you can do to get them to have a like, positive response or openness. And the book distributes several kinds of tricks that they do, and just get the person open enough to get in a little bit. And then they've done that 1%, you know, and then they can proceed from there.
Many times it's just making friends, like we discussed one day. You had to hold a class on that one day. I need to get a class about
making friends so that they appreciate a devotee. If you're just making friends, you gotta make sure to keep your eyes and ears open for chances to give them Krishna specifically. Because I'm kind of in a conversation, I might get walked over. So I might just be friends and people think, oh, he's a nice material friend and they don't know anything yet. Because I didn't get a chance to say anything. So you have to like work it right, you know, this thing of making friends to make devotees, you have to actually work it right. So anyway, that's it's true, it's for me.
Usually I found that once they get into your life a little bit, and they look at you and they say, you know, why do you put that mark on your head?
Yeah.
Or why do you not eat meat? And, you know, they want to know because they like you. But if they feel like you just go to people, don't eat me, put a mark on your head, and everybody's going to be like, oh, they're afraid. Mm-hmm. Once they know you and they feel comfortable with you and they trust you, then you can then tell them, my body is a soul of a temple. My mark and body is a temple of worship. But they're open. The communication has to begin with friendship, some kind of connection. So many times on Sanctum, we used to have to just meet a stranger and we had a bad reputation. You know. They had a cartoon where in the airport they had a Hare Krishna coming this way and a businessman coming this way, and then there's a cartoon with dust, a cloud of dust with arms and legs sticking out, and the businessman's walking away with a Bhagavad Gita stuck in his mouth.
That's just a cartoon, yeah. But in the same way, devotees can, just reading books can very quickly make a friend or attract somebody to the book. If they get really good at it, you know, they can happen very quickly. It doesn't have to be big. It can happen very quickly.
And one more question falling to that, like what can they start doing? What can they start doing, like the new person, if they're interested in something?
What can they start doing?
Yeah.
Depends if you can invite them to the Sunday feast so they can come to the temple. Suppose it's not that easy for them just doesn't work to invite them to the temple. You see them someplace far away or something and they're just on their way. I have sometimes wrote down a mantra for somebody. You have carrying a book or something and talking to that. If you have some prasadam around, you're carrying cookies or something like that. Things about who you do next. You want to know how to bring them to. If they have a book, you can tell them a little bit about the book so they're intrigued to read it. Mm-hmm. And then the next step would be for them to read it. They tell them about Krishna.com or something like that.
If you take their cell phone, they'll have to come to the temple here.
Yeah, there you go. For some. Yeah.
I have an announcement just real quick. Dr. David Knopf, he made it. He's here. So he's sponsoring the feast for everybody today. His mother-in-law is with him. And who else?
My sister-in-law, nephew, and my father-in-law, mother-in-law, Hare Krishna.
Thank you very much. So Dr. David Knopf is sponsoring for his dear mom, Haisha Prabha Devi, and this is her second disappearance anniversary. So it's Shimhanas.
Shiva Shangha.
Okay. Bravo. So, we thank you very much. Appreciate it. I'm sure all the devotees will be, very happy to take the prasad. And I humbly ask everybody to give them your blessing. And I'm sure your mother-in-law is, or your mom, excuse me, is in Vaikuntha. And, but still will.
And everybody be
praying. Hare Krishna, Hare Rama.
And while I had a chance to think a little bit, that you're kind of asking about how to bridge into the next step, too. So as you talk to somebody, you kind of look for a clue of what they're open and receptive to. And maybe you can tell them what the tea like is, or you can tell them about planning, or you can tell them about vegetarianism, or about the four rings, or whatever you feel you can get away with telling them. But you don't just tell them everything. When I was new, I used to I thought that's what you're supposed to do. So you figure out what they can be receptive to by talking with them and listening. And then you can take them to the next, you can see what the next step is that way. Yeah.
To answer a little bit, if I may, if you don't mind, get people to Hare Krishna. The very first thing you can just say is, I'm a Hare Krishna. Have you heard of the Hare Krishna? And they say, Hare Krishna? And that's, they're bigger than emotions. Because you just say Krishna once, and you have nullified numerous things that you cannot even commit. That's all nullified, just saying the word Krishna. And then once you start talking to them and explaining to them, inviting them, making a relationship, making a friendship, getting, allowing them to get to know you, then they become a little more and more interested. But really speaking, that takes a long time. The way to soften their heart is keep giving them prasada. Somehow or the other, you get them to take one raisin, one dandelion. Always have a little prasada with you in your pocket and keep giving prasada to them, because their hearts have to be softened through the purification of getting something. Then only they will be able to hear. They're not ready to hear until then. So that's some help.
Well, you said that was what I always said at first when you told me I'm Hare Krishna. I have done that too. I'm a Hare Krishna. Can you say that right? Hare Krishna, because they're learning something already. It's my religion. I want you to know it right. I just told you what I had, so you got to get it right. So can you say it right? I'm Hare Krishna. Okay, good. There's so many methods, and there's so many different personalities, and people have one strength or another strength, and each one will swear by their method, and sometimes we have little debates, but there's lots of ways that you can do things. So, anything else? Yeah.
Right. And I think that verse means where a devotee may fall, be entrapped, or seduced back into the old habit.
Yeah.
It said that it's a conditional and constitutional position for the person. So the conditional, with their souls, we're Satchitananda, we're knowledgeable, we're blissful, and we're eternal. Although being in the body, we're under these different conditions and we're entrapped sometimes. We said that if we can get around that object that we want, person, thing, situation, whatever, that entrapped us, and our pulse does not race, then we have conquered. If we get excited about being around the situation and we're still dealing.
A clue.
Yeah, it's a clue that you're still dealing with that.
Yeah.
You know? And so, Prabhupada said, though, that if our mind is fixed, and as we move, Prabhupada told me, to be a good devotee, you must use determination. If you have determination to be a devotee, Krishna knows that. And he knows when you don't have determination. And he just he's a gentleman. He'll let you go and do your thing.
Yeah, oh, Krishna.
Right. And you see devotees, they leave for 30 years, and then they come back. And I'm sure there's devotees that have left for 30 years that are not coming back in this life. But the verse you said, no loss of ignition. In the next life, they will pick up, or Krishna will arrange it so they will start over, not having lost anything.
Yeah, not start over, but start over a little time.
Exactly.
Thank you all very much for helping me give this class. I'd just like everybody contributes.
Thanks.
So, always to my